Welcome to Supernatural Iceland. My name is Valur Grettisson. I'm an editor in chief at Reykjavik Grapevine. And this is an extra show we decided to do for Christmas, for you, of course, about the most famous supernatural beings that we have in Iceland. It's the Yule lads, as well as their mother, Grýla, and of course, their crazy cat, the Yule cat, black Jóla köttur. This Yule cat here is like a troll cat, and it's probably the same size as they actually explained this in these poems. I mean, the poem that I'm talking about is by Jóhannes úr Kötlum. Jóhannes is the name, and he's from Kötlum, which is like the town that they lived in. And as you can see, they do this every year. We put this Yule cat here. He is quite frightening, isn't he? But he is also quite frightening in these stories. All of these Yule lads, as well as the Grýla, are not good monsters. They are actually terrifying, and it's really interesting how they became good. Basically, more of a traditional Christmas like beings, if you will. Jesus, Polly. Polly is relentless, of course. The thing about this is that the Yule cat, he eats children. That's the bad news. And nobody wants to meet the Yule cat. But he has a very specific taste. And his specific taste is he only eats children that are dirty, haven't been bathed, and don't have new Christmas clothes. So he only eats poor children, which is cruel, isn't it? But the point of the story at the time was, it's basically clean your children over the Christmas because everybody had to meet in a mass, like Christian mass. Icelanders were very Christian in the 18th century, and that's when these poems are becoming a thing in Iceland. But they are much, much older. For example, the story of Grýla is from like the 12th century, the first poem. But it doesn't really, you can't take that much out of it. It involves like all of these folklores. These folklores, they were basically first introduced in the same book that I've been using a lot for the Supernatural Iceland, which is these folklores and adventures by Jón Árnason that he has compiled in his lifetime. And many of these stories, especially about the Christmas Yule lads, they were actually in this book. So I'm going to explain this a little bit better to you, but this one here, you just have to bathe, then you don't have to see this monster troll cat or whatever this is. So, let's go. The Yule lads in Iceland are either 9 or 13, but they can even be more. They were first named in this book by Jón Árnason, in the 18th century, but the thing is, the most famous 13 Yule lads that we have, they are there because that's like, he couldn't name them all in all of the books, because he didn't even know about all of them until in the third book. And the thing is, the most famous ones, they are in the first book. Then they printed more names, and what's perhaps most interesting about this, we even have like a female, we have female Yule lads, and they are like just called like the name of them is basically like how is it? Is these are also weird name? Is impossible? Yeah, it's Flotsokka from Dýrafjörður in the Vestfjörðs and Flotnös úr Önundarfirði. But we never use those names. There are even more. There are like. Like Tífill, Tífall, Tútur, Baggi, Lútur, Hnútur, Rauður, Retta, Steingrímur, which is just a basic Icelandic name. And it's just it's an absolute mess. So we kind of just came up down to these 13 Christmas Yule lads. But they are really bad guys. Nobody wants them around. In the first stories of them, they actually sailed to Iceland in these skin boats that were like toughened up with the bones from the highland of Greenland. And they sailed to town, like pirates almost, to town. And they basically robbed us, stole things, and kidnapped the children, and they were evil. You did not want to meet these guys. Oh. Anyways, let's hope I don't get into trouble. Also, they are of course very nice guys today. They changed a lot after, like, there was these poems by Johannes, and they were also like a famous guy that draw these pictures of them, and they were much more friendly than we have imagined them before. So we were perhaps not that scared of them after we saw these pictures. And then slowly they became more like the American Yule lads, like Christmas guy, Santa Claus. Ready? Let's go with the street here. So these guys, they are of course the children of Grýla and Leppalúði. And Grýla is actually a terrifying monster, and she still is. Grýla has evolved a little bit. Parents just lied to their children that Grýla is dead. That's the most simple way about it. Because Grýla eats children, especially the naughty children. And let's face it, all children are naughty at some time. And we don't want to give them PTSD like our parents gave us. So we just lied to them, Grýla is dead, it's official. So, the thing is that Grýla, though, she is mentioned first in the 12th century in the Edda poems, which Snorri Sturluson wrote. A very old poems. In the same poems, you can find, for example, everything about Odin, Thor, the Nordic mythology, for example. And I just want to, like, I want to read this poem for you, because it's very old Norse. We can understand it up to a point. But it's complicated and perhaps not much to take out of it. It's more about like the name of her and what she is. And it sounds like this. Skal ek trollkvenna telja heiti Gríður og gnissa Grýla, Bría, Glumra, Geitla, Gríma og Bakrauf, Guma, Gest, Lilja, Grottin, Tanna. Grottin, Tanna is like rotten teeth. This is a bit brutal, more brutal than you think. But this woman, this troll woman, she is a very cruel creature. She basically beats her children. And we even have a song about this. We sing it like... like Jóla sveinar gangu gólf með gildan staf í hendi móði þeirra sópar gólf og flingir þá með vendi. And it basically means their mother is cleaning up the cave and then she just beats her children afterwards. Simple as that. Also, she really beats her husband, Leppalúði. And Leppalúði is a lazy guy. He doesn't do anything, and Grýla goes out and gets food for them while he waits for them. And Leppalúði is often viewed as a much more tragic person, and as an absolute side note in these fairy tales, if you will. But the thing also is that Grýla, she likes children. She's a cannibal, because she's a troll. As well as her children, they used to be like troll-like figures, but they're not very troll-like in many things. It's like they're just big and bad, basically. And Grýla, she goes to town with a big sack, and she gathers all the children that have been naughty that year, put them, of course, alive into her bag, and then she takes them back to her cave. There, she boils them alive and gives everybody something to eat. Nice, right? Well, that's Grýla for you. So Grýla is like, for example, like on the 13th, call it the 6th of January. You call it the 12th in England and the US, I think. But we call it the 13th. And this is the time when elves are moving from rock to rock. And this is the time when animals can speak and so on. But the thing is that the same time also, Grýla often visits the town and she gathers her children and takes them back to the mountains. And we have bonfires and it's pretty fun to be here actually. And a lot of kids are always at these events. But often when we do this, there are elves around, like artists being like elves, and then you have Grýla. And you can always hear some children crying their lungs out when they see Grýla. And even the parents, they like take a step back when they see that, because nobody really likes Grýla. But the thing is, of course, slowly this have changed into something more beautiful. Today, for example, instead of they break into your home and steal, kidnap your children and steal your stuff, they actually give our children gifts every day for 13 days in a row. The first Yulelættir, for example, Stekkjastaur. He has a 3-foot, exactly like a pirate. They are very like pirate-like in the description in the beginning. And the thing is that we give them something in return. For example, Kertarsnýkir, or the guy that steals your candles. So instead of like forcing him to steal your candles, we basically leave a candle next to the shoe, and the day after it's gone, of course. It's similar like you give the Santa Claus a milk, glass of milk, but we often give them stuff. And it can be actually whatever. They like, some of them just want to lick a pan, so the parents decide not to like clean the pan that they used the night before, so they can have something for themselves, and so on. And it can be a pretty interesting and funny thing to do. And of course, they give the kids like small things, and they come there 13 days in a row. And also there is one though odd Yulelætt. He's like, we don't really understand the point of him. He's like a destructive kind of a character. The only thing he does is that he basically slams doors. So if you hear like slamming doors that night, then that's probably hurðaskellir, like we call it. So, like I said, it's like our Yulelætts are, there are many more. It would be actually interesting because all of these folklores, like none of them are, like they have been changing so rapidly past like what, 100 or 200 years, that we could actually, it would be fine if we would add these two female Yule women. They're actually just called like the Yule hags from the Vestfjord. This is not nice thing to say, but that's where they are basically. And they steal like fat or want fat, like meat fat, and it's always about food or something very simple. So I think I'm not forgetting anything. This is basically our tradition when it comes to anything. When it comes to the Christmas, it's lovely, I have to say. It's really convenient when you're a kid and you have Yulelætts with gifts for what, 13 days in a row. I love this. So it's like, it is what it is. Thanks for watching. Merry Christmas. I hope you're all having a very nice time. Just remember, if you want to like learn about these Yulelætts, you can buy beautiful books in our bookstores that Brian Pilkington did. He draws these Yulelætts actually in a very traditional way, but with a very snarky, funny way to do it. And he also explains one and each of them. And these are definitely odd and interesting creatures, both frightening as well as like very exciting at the same time. So, on with the butter, like I say.